Hey, we're so glad that you could join us here on our podcast at Ashland Christian Fellowship. You will notice different voices from gifted men and women as we discuss relevant and encouraging topics. And don't forget to subscribe either to our YouTube channel or Spotify. We hope you enjoy today's topic and that the Lord speaks to you. God bless.
Well, hey guys, welcome back to our ACF podcast. I'm super excited to be here, and I'm really glad to be joined by Pastor Mark.
Nice to be here.
This afternoon, and Heather Timmons.
Yep. Thank you.
Love having glad you on. Here. And we're super excited for a podcast today. Yeah. Before we jump into our podcast, though, I have had some comments about these headphones that we wear. They're quite fashionable, as you've noticed. And I've had people ask, why do we wear these headphones? Well, to understand that, you need to go back in the context of our ACF podcast. And it goes way back to March, which isn't that far back. But when COVID first started and we decided we were going to do a podcast, we had this idea of interviewing people and their testimonies and cool things like that. And we weren't sure it was going to be a video podcast. We were thinking it was going to be an audio podcast. So when we originally set up our system, we set it up with microphones and headphones for more of the audio feel because it helps regulate the sound. You can hear your own voice. It helped the people we were interviewing because we got these big mics in front of our faces. Some of the testimonies we were capturing, people are a little maybe harder of hearing, and having the headphones help them hear our questions and stuff like that. But it's kind of just stuck, and maybe we'll get away from it. I've heard people think it looks kind of funny, but they feel really nice. And it's really great getting to hear everyone's voices. I don't know if you guys like it.
Well, I think you look cool.
I appreciate that, Mark.
Do I look cool?
You do look cool.
Yeah. I feel like I should be flying an airplane.
I don't feel cool anymore now that you said that. So anyways, that's the long story behind the headphones. So anyways.
I didn't know people had asked questions.
Yeah, I've had people ask questions like, why do you wear those headphones? And you know, that's why, because we were thinking of doing an audio podcast, not a video podcast, and now it's become both. And Brett's got these cool little swinging microphones. Man, I love them so much. It's just made it so much easier.
Small things entertain small people.
It's true. What do they say? Simple minds, simple pleasures.
That's the phrase that's I was looking for.
I've heard it.
Yeah, that's what I was looking for.
Yeah, that's okay. God makes people with simple minds for simple reasons. This is what we got going on today, though. We're actually talking about shame in our podcast.
Yeah.
And I'm really excited to get into it. I really know nothing about this. I'm an expert on knowing what shame feels like, and maybe you are too.
I have a master's degree.
Yeah, I have a master's. I have my PhD, you know? We all feel shame when we do something wrong. And I want to start it off, if that's okay, with this definition from our English dictionary. I love words. I love definitions. This is what it says. The definition of shame is a painful feeling of humiliation or distress caused by the consciousness of wrong or foolish behavior. A painful feeling of humiliation or distress caused by the consciousness of wrong or foolish behavior. I think that's a good definition.
I think so too. Yeah.
Adequately describes it. A painful feeling of humiliation or distress caused by inappropriate behavior. Shame.
Yeah.
Talk to me about shame, guys.
Are we supposed to dive in there somewhere?
I think it's good just to kind of like open that up from the beginning. I have some thoughts. I think if you're ever going to understand something like the headphones, you have to go back to the beginning.
Okay.
And personally, when I think of shame and how it has plagued mankind, I feel like you have to go back to the beginning. When was the first time shame was experienced? And it would have had to have been, though it doesn't say it explicitly, the Garden of Eden.
Yeah, they hid themselves because they were naked. And it wasn't necessarily because they were naked, because they were naked before.
Yeah.
But it was the act of disobedience that brought about the shame. And I think it was the fig leaves that was their attempt to try to cover that up.
Well, this is what I find so interesting about that, is they were obviously ashamed when they sinned.
Right.
And that connects shame to not being in right position with God.
Right.
Because that's where it was originally at. They had wronged one another. They had wronged God. So there's this air in relationship with God, with fellow man. And they feel this intense shame. And I like how you said it's not because they were naked. It's because of the disobedience. Because if you go back to before that, when they were in right relationship with God and with one another, it says they were naked and unashamed. It's actually what it says. Yeah. So they didn't even have shame before.
Right.
Right.
Shame really entered in when man first sinned.
Right. And I think we'll talk about this hopefully later, that there's a place for shame and a power in shame to push us to do right.
Yeah.
There's rightful shame.
Godly sorrow.
Sorrow. And right. And the appropriate real guilt that would come from bad behavior, to give you, use your definition. But it's what you do with it. And it's what shame mm-hmm. propels you towards, I think, that really be where it gets its negative power.
Yeah. So we've defined shame a little bit. Let's talk a little bit, though, about the kind of the action or the consequences of shame, because shame does have negative effects mm-hmm. on yours and mine's life. Maybe you've experienced that. Maybe you're experiencing it presently. Living under shame, it does mm-hmm. things to people.
Yeah. Well, and I, you know, not to make it too simplistic, but I think that the truth is when you feel shameful, you act shameful.
Yeah.
If you get yourself convinced that not only did I do a bad thing, but I'm a bad person, once that attaches itself to you, then there's really lessened restraint to continue in that bad behavior or to find some other way to act out.
Yeah.
So it does have incredible power. It drives a lot of bad behavior.
It does. And I feel like it's really been a tool of Satan to drive people to deeper darkness.
I do too.
Have you ever maybe, like, you've done something, you feel a little bit guilty, and it maybe wasn't the worst thing ever, but then there's that shameful feeling like, well, if you've already done this, you might as well just go off. Yeah, you know I mean, totally yeah. just
and
end
I have
the cycle.
40 years of ministry to give you stories, and I won't give them because it's really inappropriate, some of the specifics, but I have watched that dozens of times.
Yeah.
When people make a mistake and then they go, well, now I've gone too far.
I'm toast anyways.
Just, they just dive on in. It's like they go all the way headlong into it because of the fact that shame has taken a toll on their heart and on their restraint system. They don't have any reason not to anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about the first thing we see from shame in the Garden of Eden, and that was they hid themselves from God.
Right. Suddenly their conduct became absurd.
Yeah.
Right? Like, to
I like
them,
the way
it
you
made
said
sense.
It. Yeah.
Right?
Absurd.
But
yeah.
suddenly it really was absurd. Like, how do you hide from God? You can't. And yet all of their attention went to hiding from God and sewing together leaves and not doing the tasks that God had actually tasked them with.
Yeah.
Right? Suddenly they're off the trajectory.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's really great, Heather. Shame caused them to act absurd.
Yeah.
I'm glad you said that first, by the way, because I tend to say absurd with a Z, and my wife always calls me on it. So you saying it with an S reminded me that I need to say it with an S on the podcast. Absurd. But they did.
Yeah.
Like, they sin, and then it's like, oh my gosh, we're naked.
Right.
And that wasn't a problem before, but it's a problem now.
Right.
So they get fig leaves. I don't know. How big are fig leaves?
Well, the ones around here aren't very big.
They're not. Okay. How many fig leaves would you need? Like a little popcorn string?
Yeah, you got to sew them babies together.
I mean, I heard. Right. I mean, we could talk about a different podcast. So, like, you know, they call it the what is that called? Oh, no, guys, I spaced it. What do they call those rooms where it's their glass and the plants are in them? And
terrarium?
Yeah, kind of. Like
a greenhouse.
There it is. I was gonna say green room, but I'm like, no, that's not it. Greenhouse. They do. I know there are groups that, and I think so too. The Earth had a greenhouse effect, and thus vegetation would have been bigger, able to support dinosaurs and bigger life. So maybe the fig leaves were bigger. Let's go with that.
Right.
Maybe they were bigger. You didn't need so many. But they sew fig leaves together, and then, like you said, it's absurd. They hide from God, and that's the first thing you see about shame is isolation.
Yeah.
Yes.
And that's the first step. And we were talking about that shame cycle earlier. There's been psychological studies, and they write up these cycles of shame, how this leads you to this, which leads you to this, which leads you back to where you were, and you spiral again.
Yeah.
And isolation is like one of the first steps. Shame produces isolation.
Right.
And isolation will cause me to do all sorts of things.
Right.
Secrecy and
Well, and that's, deceit. You know, it led to the argument and the blame casting and finger pointing with each other. But it was the basis that I feel bad. I've got to find somebody to, you know, blame it on instead of taking responsibility, which would have led to, the, you know, forgiveness and the removal of shame. They just started blaming each other. You did it and you did it. And, you know,
well, this is one of my next points. Yeah. And so we'll get there when we get there. I love where you're going with it. But what I want to open up is the isolation piece, because that is the first step people tend to move towards when they've done something wrong, is withdrawing from God, withdrawing from people. And the reason I wanted to stop and talk about it is because you have opportunity right there to cut it off.
Yeah.
Right.
You honestly do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, I think you actually get fractured. The act of disobedience or violating your own conscience. I mean, even people who don't like to talk about sin and they don't want to talk about right and wrong, they have a moral code that they live by, whatever that is. And when they violate that, there's an automatic fracturing of the soul where you feel separated even from your true ideal self.
Yeah.
Now you've got this monster that you're trying to cope with. Well, you're hiding even from yourself. You begin to tell yourself lies or excuses or victimizing or, I mean, all kinds of things. So you're right. I mean, the isolation, but it's not just isolating from others, but it certainly plays out in relationships and...
Yeah. Heather, talk to me about this, because chances are you've seen this a lot as a mom. Have you ever seen, like, the little kid does something wrong, and it's like
you can see it in their face,
the shame, and then like the isolation, they're like hiding in their bedroom under their sheets, and you're like, what have you done? They're like, nothing. I had a lot of siblings, you know, like, so tell me about it. How do you see that playing out, that isolation piece? And then also, I love that idea that if you find yourself isolating, you could stop right there. You don't have to go through the whole shame cycle. You can come clean.
Yeah.
Well, the thing that first came to mind when you mentioned, like, lying, I think when we're battling shame, we lie to ourselves first.
Oh, that's one of the first lies we tell.
Yeah, we tell ourselves the lie. We rehearse it in our mind, and then we tell it, you know, to God, to whoever we choose to tell it to. So I think it's that not telling ourselves the truth is kind of that first, that first step. And then, like you said, back to the absurd things where, as a small child, they're hiding or they're denying the obvious thing. And yet we do the same thing, right? Like, to us, we're adults, so we're a little more clever about it, but it's the same thing.
Oh, yeah.
And we're laid bare before God, and people who know us know that something's off. And we, you know, you do the whole, I'm fine. It's fine. Right? We've all heard that or said that. It's fine. I'm fine. When we're not.
No, we're not.
Right.
Yeah.
And I think there's a way that it shows up in a, I don't know how necessarily, but it shows up. You can sense it in other people sometimes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's true.
Well, so that withdrawal piece is the first one. Like you said, as adults, we get a little bit better at hiding that we're withdrawing, and we're better at lying to ourselves. I think that was so good. We rehearse it. We lie to ourselves. We kind of buy it. We lie to God. He doesn't buy it.
Right. Right.
The devil tells us, like, no, it's true. Like, you know what I mean? Like, we lie to him, and he agrees with it. And
he justifies it.
He justifies it. And that's the first place. And it's hard. It's hard to come clean. But this is what was so absurd about it. They ran from God, who is the source of forgiveness, redemption, and life.
Right.
And that's the that's what I picked up from it. Like, shame caused them to turn from the only one who could deliver them from their shame.
Yep.
And he eventually would deliver man from shame in the cross.
Yeah.
In Jesus Christ. And it doesn't mean you and I don't struggle with shame and guilt, things like that, but we have an atonement in Jesus Christ. You can go back, read 1 John. But Jesus is the source of redemption, forgiveness, and healing and deliverance from shame and guilt. He really is. And so that's why I feel like the isolation part is so destructive, because the first thing you do is you cut yourself off from others who are going to help you, by the way. If you have true community of friends in your life, they're going to help you get back on the track and back on the track with God. And that's where the source of healing is. But that's what we cut off.
Right.
I feel so ashamed. Like, how can I come to God? And then I buy the lies from Satan that say, you're just a monster. You know, God won't forgive you. You've blown it again, maybe. You know, if it's habitual, you've blown it again. And you're going to ask for forgiveness again. And it's really hard to get over that.
Well, especially if you don't learn the beauty of repentance. You know, we see that as the last stage, something we just don't want to do, because we have to lose face with someone else, with God, or we got to admit the truth that we don't want to admit to ourselves.
Yeah.
And then as a consequence, we put off our own healing, which is ridiculous and sad.
Ridiculous.
It's absurd. Another variation of this absurd idea.
It is absurd. I think part of the issue with the repentance thing, when people are struggling with it, is because I've been there before in my life, where maybe you've blown it and you want to repent, but maybe that's not the first time you've blown it.
Right.
And you're like, okay, I'm just going to go repent. And then there's that, like, voice from the devil's like, are you really repentant?
Yeah, did you really repent last time?
Yeah, like, what are you talking? You've told God this sad story before, and you just, and that's how Satan works. It's like the guilt.
Yeah.
That's why Paul would say, who's he who condemns you?
Right.
We all know the answer to that one.
Right.
Yep. No one needs to be told. But then he says, who's he who justifies you?
Well, and I don't have any scripture to back this up, but I think shame has layers where you lay down a layer and then you either cover it up or you move on and there's another layer that comes on and it actually gets crusty where your heart can just get so full of layers and layers and layers of shame where all of a sudden now your sensitivity to the Spirit is gone, your sensitivity to others is gone, you get used to isolating and that just leads to a cycle that's just destructive.
Like a Pillsbury Doughboy, flaky layered, you know what I'm talking about?
Biscuit, I love the flaky,
but then
the
you let it out,
biscuits.
You let it dry, and all those flaky, buttery biscuit layers just get hard as rock. You got to break through them one at a time.
Yeah.
Nobody likes it. Stale biscuit is gross.
Yep.
It's true, though.
God can handle your stale biscuits. If you learn anything today, God can handle your stale biscuits. Remember that.
That's a deep
word. Actually, I have a great story about this shame playing out in a kid's life. So I have lots of siblings, and I won't name drop this one, but it is my youngest brother. So if you know my family, then you'll know who it is. And he comes in from the backyard, and he's just got the look of shame hanging upon him. And, you know, I'm quite a bit older than my youngest sibling. So, I can see it. We can all see it. He walks in. He's very little this time. And my mom looks at him. She goes, so-and-so, what did you do? And he's like, I did nothing. Because he just came in from outside, right? He's like, I've done nothing. And she's like, tell me what'd you do? And we're all watching this. He's like, I've done nothing. She goes, you peed in the lawn, didn't you? And he goes,
how did she know?
This is how the story gets even better. He goes, no, I didn't. She goes, you threw rocks at the dog. And he goes, no. She goes, you threw rocks at Max, who's our old Labrador. And he goes, I was trying to throw it over his head. And we were all like leaning over, looking at my mom. And she's like, don't do it again. You know, it's okay, but don't do it again. He like leaves. We're like, mom, how did she know? And she goes, well, when it comes to little boys, it's either peeing in the lawn or throwing rocks at the dog. It's literally what my mom said. She raised six boys, so she knows what she's talking about. But
I'll bet there's another story there somewhere.
I know. I was like, so which one of us was the one who peed in the lawn all the time? I have my suspicions.
Poor Max.
Poor Max. Bless him. He passed away. But wonderful dog. Labradors are great. Back to shame. So isolation. So I think this is good for application because maybe you listen to this podcast and you're a person who's bound by layers of shame. Or just a lot of shame right now, and you are isolating yourself. Mm-hmm. And the first thing we would want to tell you is stop isolating yourself. You need to come clean with God, and if necessary, come clean with others. And come clean with yourself. And just be honest and say, what I have done is wrong. Yeah. And maybe it is habitual, and you feel like I can't be repentant. You can be repentant. I think it's a process of turning back to the Lord and just saying, Lord, have mercy. And just knowing that when we turn to God, there's forgiveness. And Dave would say, our sin is removed, and we'll talk about it later. As far as the east is from the west, like we remember what we've done, Satan will remember what we've done, but when we've repented and we experience God's forgiveness, the reality is God doesn't remember.
Right.
I've always heard people say, and I struggle believing it, but they say you come back to God and you say, I've done it again, and God looks at you and says, again.
Mm-hmm. Hmm.
And I don't know if it's actually like that, but it's the idea that he's forgotten, he's forgiven. And so you need to come back to the light. And this is what 1 John says. I'll just read it real quick. I love this so much. I was reading this earlier today. And whenever you're struggling with guilt, 1 John is like a balm. But it says, says this right here. It says, this is the message which we have heard from him and declare to you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. And we go, oh, the shame, right? Mm-hmm. Oh, man, I'm a failure. But then he says, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. There's restoration. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. It's only, we're not practicing the truth when we walk in darkness and we keep it hidden. But when we bring it to the light, we walk in the light, there's forgiveness, there's cleansing. And then he says, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. That's the lie.
Yep.
Well, wasn't that wrong? John goes, no, you're lying to yourself. The truth's not in you. If we confess our sins, the right thing to do when we've sinned and there's shame, we want to isolate. And I love what Mark said, and we're going to that next, in the garden was to say, well, it's their fault, it's their fault.
Yeah.
It's to not accept what you have done. But if you can accept and say, no, I've sinned, and if we can confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I love that he added that there. It would have been enough to say God forgives, but to add that God cleanses, because when we've transgressed in the soul, we feel like we've crossed a line that goes against moral code, there's a feeling of just dirty, splotchy, and yet he says God can cleanse, and he does cleanse even that when we're repentant. I think that's powerful.
I do too.
So if you're in isolation right now, stop isolating, come to the light, let Jesus Christ cleanse you.
Yeah. And when you say come to the light, I just want to clarify one thing that I had wrong for so many years. The idea of walking in darkness, I understood, was a consequence of disobedience. What I didn't see was coming to the light is not about getting cleaned up, improving. It's just about owning what the light has revealed.
Yeah.
Light exposes.
Yeah.
Light brings clarity. And so if it exposes sin and darkness, the good news is there's blood that's been shed to cleanse that.
Yeah.
But if you hide from that light and you dim it, you pull away, well, then you're living in this no man's land where you're forgiven, but you're not enjoying it. There's freedom, but you're not experiencing it.
Yeah.
And there's all kinds of things that happens. I mean, if you think about married couples even, you know, intimacy is based on truth and fidelity. And if I lie to you, if I mislead you or withhold information from you, our intimacy goes down. You know, there's just no truth there. But all it takes to restore it is for you to turn the light on. Just turn the light on. Here's the reality.
Yeah.
And, man, it is so beautiful when you see couples learn to tell the truth with each other and not excuse or blame or victimize. Just tell the truth.
Yeah.
Man, it is freeing. But I think it starts with God, learning to do that with God.
Well, and that's so good what you said, Mark. It's not like I clean up my act and come to the light.
That's what we think we have to do, though.
I let the light in. And as we know, when light enters a room, it pushes the darkness out.
Yeah, automatically.
Yeah, so let the light in. God will push the darkness out. You just got to let the light in.
Yeah, otherwise you end up with what I call an old Adam self-improvement society, where in order to get back into the light, I have to do these steps. I got to stop this. I got to make up for that. I got to pay back or do penance for whatever wrong I've done and earn my way back into the light. Well, man, good luck with that.
Yeah.
You're never going to get fully there. And if you do, it's going to be a self-induced, pride-filled, look how good I am kind of a consequence. That's what religion is all about.
Yeah.
Trying to make people feel better about themselves.
Trying to make yourself feel right with God.
Yeah.
Heather, before we move on, I want to hear your thoughts. Laura jumped on me for the last podcast.
Because we didn't talk to her very much.
Yeah, we didn't let Mark and I get preaching. We're pastors. We just start preaching. Okay. So you gotta fight here a little bit.
All right.
What do you got?
All right, throw a few elbows here.
You gotta throw some elbows around.
Well, my first thought was, you talk about being in community, being in relationship.
Yeah.
When we're in relationship constantly, it helps to clear out that sin. It brings that light in and keeps it shining in there, right?
Yeah.
When you are regularly in community with people and regularly sharing what's going on inside, not just the I messed up, now I have to go and talk to someone. That's excruciatingly painful.
It is.
But when it's part of an ongoing friendship or relationship, and it's just part of sharing how your day went when it was good and how your day went when it was bad, you have this habit of sharing and living in the light and walking in the light. And you have that accountability of knowing that, okay, if I mess up, I'm going to be talking to this person. And that in itself is a deterrent.
Yeah.
That in itself helps to keep us walking in a manner worthy of our calling, as we were talking about, and I opened up to Ephesians. We want to walk in that manner. So that's the thing I was thinking about.
That's awesome, Heather.
And that's something that you can establish in advance. I mean, you build that relationship.
Right.
You go deep with one another.
Yeah.
And you give yourself and them permission just by virtue of being in relationship and having a trust built up with one another where it's okay to talk about difficult or embarrassing or shameful things.
Yes.
It's okay. Yeah. And the reason I know it's okay is because I've already demonstrated or committed to this relationship the willingness to say, listen, I'm going to forgive you no matter what.
Right.
Yeah.
And I'm going to expect you to forgive me no matter what.
Right.
Yeah.
So when we have that basis, now we can help each other.
Yes.
Yeah. I have a story I love to tell, and I've told it multiple times, about two Africans I met back in California some years ago. And I noticed every morning they would greet each other different than Americans do. Instead of saying, how are you, they would look each other in the eye, and it was kind of awkward because Africans touch each other, and so they're holding hands and they're looking at each other right in the eye, yeah. and they would say to each other, "How am I today, brother?" And they said it with this real accent, you know, and they would look deep in each other's eyes, and they'd say, "I sense you are struggling, my brother." And they read each other, and I think what they were reading was this whole thing of, "Are you in the light? Are you walking in truth?" Or has something happened? Are you worried about something? Have you failed in some way? And all I got to see, of course, because they don't know me, was the beauty of the way that they loved each other.
Yeah.
It was okay to be real
because
they knew that there was forgiveness in advance already offered. It was beautiful. Yeah. I don't think we Americans really have much of that, but I do have a couple of friends where I just don't have to fake it.
Yep. Yeah.
How valuable is that?
Yeah.
You know, you can just say, hey, the naked raw truth, this is the way it is. But those relationships have to be built in advance, and I'm glad that you said that.
Well, we have a very independent culture that values image.
And we're proud of it.
Yeah. I'm very proud of it. So that's why shame is so hard for us. It's different from a shame and honor culture, like a lot of Asian cultures are shame and honor. But for us, it's more, I think, because it's based on our image. And our ego and our pride.
Yeah.
We can, admitting you have weakness and failure and need help, it's just really hard for people to do.
Yeah.
American people. It's just part of our ingrained culture.
Right. Can I add something to that?
No, you can't. Mark, you and I will
There's an elbow. She's throwing an elbow.
That was a nice
Let
elbow.
Me in.
Especially if it's an ongoing thing, right? It's one thing to go to someone and to say...
Cody and I have talked about this a little bit, but go ahead.
Yeah. It's one thing to go in to say, I've messed up. But it's another thing when it's the fifth or sixth time.
Yep.
And you need someone who's not going to give you that lie of, why don't you get it together? What's wrong with you? Because you're already telling yourself that.
Yeah, exactly.
You need someone who's going to speak like Jesus, which is get you up, dust you off.
Yeah.
Forgive you, remind you of who you are, and help you walk in it, and also have that vision of you that is an identity that's built on Jesus.
Yeah.
You know, you are his child. You are, right? You are more than your sin. That doesn't identify, what is it? Identify you? Or that's not your identity.
Associate you.
Yeah, I don't know.
I think one of the pitfalls of doing it wrong is, I love this idea John Maxwell has. He says, what you focus on expands. He's using it as a leadership principle. But it's like baseball. They told us, because I was a pitcher, they're like, do not be up on the mound and tell yourself, don't hit the guy, don't hit the guy, don't hit the guy. Because the first thing you're going to do is being the guy with the ball. Like, it's just psychological. It's like telling someone, don't think about a purple elephant. The first thing I think about is a purple elephant.
Right.
And I think you can get in a place where you're so focused on your shame or your struggle that it can expand. And I think friendships can become that way too, where you're so focused on always asking the other person about their struggle or them always talking about their struggle that it actually engulfs the friendship. Mm-hmm. And I've seen friendships get weird or messed up, or I feel like they can get ruined when it just becomes so centered on your struggle.
Mm-hmm.
Like, and that's the extreme, right? The pendulum swings to the extreme, but that is an extreme that people can get to. And I think that's a pitfall we can fall into, where I make my whole identity, my whole world about my struggle.
Right.
And the reality is God has so much more for you than what you're temporarily struggling with now.
Right.
And even in the midst of your struggle, God has so much life and victory for you to experience on a daily basis.
Yeah. I love that. It triggered me though a little bit. I remember back in the 80s when there was a lot of emphasis on accountability groups.
Yeah.
We were encouraging men to get into accountability groups and whatnot. But it became this external, sin-focused, sin-sniffing kind of a relationship.
Right.
And so it did help to, you know, guys to address their stuff. But the ongoing downside of it was it became all about my sin, all about my failure, all about, have you done this? Are you doing this? Are you telling me the truth?
Well, then you just dread
the small group.
You hate it because you get in there. The small group leader is going to open up with, so who struggled with lust this past week? And you're like, what kind of a question is that? You know what I mean? Like, we really got to talk. And you're like, what kind of a question is that?
So became kind of, I like to, and maybe it's a way, way exaggeration, but it was kind of became like this Christian Gestapo where we're really, now we're going to aggressively try to fix you.
Yeah.
And you're going to fix me. I don't think it works. I think the only kind of accountability works is what Heather talked about, where I have this loving relationship with this individual. I don't want to say, for the fifth time, I've messed up.
Yeah.
That has an inherent, you know, deterrent to continuing in bad behavior. But if even if I do, I'm not going to get shamed by them. Right. I'm going to get built up by them.
Yeah.
And that's when it works.
Yeah. And it's not the entirety of the relationship.
No.
Like you were saying, yeah. the whole relationship isn't built around one person's failure.
Yeah.
Right? It's a whole relationship and it's one facet of it that.
Yeah. yeah.
Right.
Yeah. I think that's a good word from John Maxwell, where you focus on expands.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So like focus on the Lord. That's what God's been trying to teach me. Like, focus on the, let the Lord expand in your life. Yep. Let the light in, and the light's going to drive back the darkness. Like we all fail. We all struggle. But when you focus on that, that's where like your struggle expands and Satan just hammers you over the head and you can't live there.
Right. Yep.
It's just going to ruin your life. And there's so many good things God's doing in your life today.
Yes.
I feel like that's the tricky thing about guilt and shame. Let's say I blew it, let's say like a week ago or something. Well, we've all been there when we've done that. And then that whole, the whole week, all you can think about is how you messed up on that one area. You know what I'm talking about?
And you waste all the time that you could have enjoyed with the Lord and with your life.
And then you start and you look back, but look at all the good things God had been doing that week.
Yep.
Yep.
Because that's the whole part about the repentance and God removing and forgiving and forgetting. You know, yet here we are wallowing and Satan just has us wallowing and that's what he wants.
Yep.
Yeah. So now I'm starting to preach. Sorry. So let's move on to the next thing. Brett, how are we doing for time?
25-30 minutes.
Nice. This is good. I love it. These are good podcasts. I'm genuinely looking forward to listening to this podcast over again. I've just loved this conversation. So, Mark, you had talked about how shame causes you to pass guilt, to blame others. And I think that's another big aspect. And we use the term victimization. Is that right?
Yeah.
Victimizing or playing the victim. But I think that's what it comes from. Not knowing how to deal with your own shame. So you blame everyone else.
Yep.
Because you can't accept responsibility. Go ahead and talk to us about that, Mark.
Well, I think, you know, it's a subtle trick of the devil. It's twofold, I think, where he can make you feel shameful and just heap it on you, and you just join this, you know, I feel like a loser, so I act like a loser, and I must be a loser, and blah, blah, blah. And nobody wants to stay there. So eventually, people began to find, you know, if you hadn't said what you did, and if my parents hadn't have done what they did, if this person would have been better, or if I would have gotten what I needed, I wouldn't. And all that stuff sets in motion this victimization, which leads me to find somebody to blame for my bad behavior.
You're saying this is a coping mechanism.
It's a sharing, moving, spreading out the pain, but it really is ineffective. It destroys relationships. It distorts my view of myself. It's not healthy. And it's the solution is so simple and yet so difficult.
Yeah.
Where you just, like we said before, you turn the light on. You just say, it's me and me only. It's like David in Psalm 51, against you and you only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight. I don't deserve to be forgiven, but I know that only by forgiveness can I experience freedom.
Yeah.
So it's a cycle.
When I love this. I love that you brought it up, and I want you to jump in on it, Heather. I want to put this idea off you, because people, when they play the victim, they say, because this happened to me as a child, or because, you know, this, or because my coffee was made wrong. You know what I mean? Like, because we think of big things, but it's honestly on a small level. Like, I experienced this, the temptation of this, on a leadership level. Mm-hmm. When someone comes to me and says, hey, when you said this to the person, that wasn't very nice. It's like, well, I said this because they said this first, right? This is a really common one. And the idea is I've been wrong, so thus I behave this way. And that's the light of it, because you can be wronged on the small, on small offenses, or we think of people that have been wronged on huge offenses that just mess them up. And that's real. You have been wronged. And there needs to be healing for that. There needs to be accountability for that. If there needs to be justice for that, there needs to be justice for that. And trusting that God's going to deal with it. But that doesn't negate your own personal responsibility for what you do now.
Exactly.
Next.
Yeah.
And I think that's where people get off, is because of these wrongs, I'm no longer responsible for my actions. And that's not true.
No,
God makes it clear. We're all going to be accountable someday for our actions.
Yep.
I know something that's helped me walking through a painful situation where I didn't know if there was going to be resolution, and that was to just practice gratitude and thankfulness. I went through a period of time where I couldn't even pray about it, because I was rehearsing my own hurt in my mind. Suddenly,
I've never been there. I
started out praying, and pretty soon I'm like rehearsing my case.
You're pulling the file out.
Lord, I pray for so-and-so, that stubborn, two-headed Leviathan, Lord. I'm just pray for my...
Right.
I've been there.
Right. And so one of the things that the Lord showed me, just through a lot of what Paul says in his letters, is thankfulness, practice thankfulness. And there was literally a period of time where I felt like the Lord was like, don't even talk to me unless it's what you're thankful for. Not that I couldn't talk to him, but it was like, you're not talking to me anyway. So no. Just tell me what you're thankful for. And like every prayer was a prayer of praise and thanksgiving. And it was hard, but it was so good for me because when I wanted to complain, I would think, how do I rephrase this as a prayer of gratitude? And sometimes it was, God, thank you that you know. Thank you that you're working in this.
You get it.
You know. Yeah, that's I don't need so to funny. Unpack it in my mind for the 100th time.
Lord, thank you that know. They're a jerk, but you are good. It's gratitude, Lord. I'm thankful for evil, wicked people like them who show me how gracious you are.
Baby steps. He takes us right where we're
baby
at.
Baby steps. Oh, my gosh. I'm so glad you bring that because I've definitely been there in seasons where I'm like, I can't even pray about it or think about it because all I do right. is just get angry,
yeah.
you know?
Well, yeah.
And
yeah.
you need to be grateful instead. That's such a good yeah. word.
Yeah. And brain chemistry shows us that when we rehearse those things, we're training our brain to think of the negative thing.
Yeah, and so, how we were the victim.
Right.
That's right. how we do it. Like, Lord, I was wronged, obviously, and I did wrong, but I did wrong because of their great wrongs, Lord. Right. And I accept my small wrongs, Lord, in light of their great wrongs. And I'm thankful that you're going to hold them accountable for it. You know what I mean? Like, we go through these things. God must laugh. Yeah. When you said that, it made me think of the parent who's like, I don't want to, if you can't say anything nice, don't say anything at all, you know?
Right. Right.
God's like, I don't want to hear it unless it's gratitude.
Yeah.
Well, and it's just a downward spiral. When I won't take responsibility for whatever reaction I had to your action,
yep.
I perpetuate the problem and escalate it.
Yep.
If yeah. I say, I yelled at you because you yelled at me first, there's no resolution, and there yeah. never yeah. will be.
Right.
You know, no. they right. would say, well, I wouldn't have yelled at you if you hadn't made me mad.
Right.
Well, when is somebody going to say, yeah. I have responsibility for my own choices.
Yeah.
Even if my choices came after your choices, I still right. have responsibility for my choices.
Right.
And if I take everything that I did and own it, now all of a sudden, if I said, yeah, you know, I really shouldn't have reacted that way.
Well, and it's
now all of a sudden it's going the other way.
And I feel yeah. like that proverb, a soft answer turns away wrath,
yes.
yep.
is a good.
Yes.
It really captures that. Like
yep.
they made their
yep.
choice. They're angry. Now you make your choice.
Yep.
And your choice can dismiss their anger even.
It can.
Right. Diffuse the situation. You choosing to do what's right can diffuse the situation.
Yeah.
Right.
Man, this is so good. And here's what I want to say. This is just a side note. But when we do this with ourselves, we actually cap our own ability to grow.
Yeah.
We really do.
And that's yeah. And I think that's been kind of the underlying principle that I've wanted to see us talk about is that I'm not only hurting myself, I'm limiting myself.
Yeah, you really are.
You know, and I'm robbing myself of incredible freedom.
Yeah.
And liberty and joy and experience and deeper relationships. And honesty and transparency, and so many beautiful things that I just put a lid on because
yeah.
I don't want to feel the shame, so I find some way to justify it, and it just perpetuates.
Yeah, yeah. So don't live in isolation.
No.
Don't live yep. in victimization. It's
yep.
like take responsibility
yep.
and experience growth. Let the light in and let God allow you
yep.
to grow. You would be amazed the amount of character, leadership, mm-hmm. wisdom, all these things that God wants to grow in your life, integrity and honesty, morality. Like God will grow you in ways you didn't think was possible. If you don't believe
yeah.
me, go read Galatians 5:22, where it talks about the fruit of the Spirit.
Yeah.
You read that and you go, man, I wish I was like that. Well, the whole reason he put that in there is because you can be like that. That's what
yeah.
happens when you walk in the light, walk in the Spirit, and let God in, and he starts to change things.
Yep.
But the growth takes time.
Yep.
You know, you never, you don't plant a tree. I worked on a forestry farm for a bit. You don't plant a tree and then come back the next day and see a 160-foot, you know, Douglas fir. It just doesn't work that way.
No.
Yeah.
It takes time. It takes years. There's good seasons. There's bad seasons.
Yep. Yeah.
You know?
Well, you can grow something in 6 months, you know, if it's a squash.
Yeah.
You know, but.
You think
yeah.
of that seminary story.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah,
that's a good
yeah,
one.
Yeah, that's a good one, man. But I think that's the truth. It's going to take some time.
You know, I had a really cool moment recently. I was back on the farm. I was visiting Rick, and I was just in town for something. I don't remember what I was doing now, but Rick and I are meeting up, and he said, hey, you know, his wife makes these beautiful homemade wreaths, and she sells them, like packages them. They ship around the U.S., you know?
Yeah.
And beautiful wreaths that she makes. And he said, hey, she needs some holly. Let's go up above the ridge and get holly. So it's up on this mountainous territory and hillish territory, I guess I should say. And you have to take the quads to get up there. And while we're back there, we're going deep because he owns 110 acres and then it spills out into more forestry land. And we stopped the quads in this one area. He goes, do you remember this? And I'm standing in a forest that I helped him plant years ago.
Oh, that's got to be cool.
For real. It was surreal. Like, I remember when the trees were this tall.
Yeah.
And now the trees are like, oh, I don't know, up to 30 feet maybe or whatever. And
wow,
13, 15, 30 feet. And,
yep.
And it was surreal. And standing there in that, and you see the growth, because I was on that farm for a few years, and there was one year we had a drought, and I didn't know if those trees were going to make it. Well, I remember him and I going out there and looking at that small forest and seeing some of them browning out and dying. You're like, are these trees even going to make it? I remember he explained to me that when a tree is small, he's vulnerable to grass. And I mean, even something like grass can kill a small tree, shaded out, or blackberries or deer, all these things. But as they grow taller, as they experience growth, all those threats become less threatening. And then it gets to that point where the tree just explodes in his growth. And then it just shoots way up because he's no longer affected by all the minor things that used to hold him down.
Man, there's a lot of
analogies.
Isn't
that an analogy?
There,
and I think like that's how God grows us. You may feel like this is the end of the world, but it's not.
Yeah.
You're just a small little tree right now, and you're struggling in this area. Satan's got you pinned, and it feels like the blackberries and the pokes and all that. But God's going to grow you when you let the light in, and eventually you become bigger than those problems, and the growth is exponential. What once held you down no longer holds you down anymore.
Yeah.
And then I feel like it is a surreal moment when you come back years later and you say, remember when I was there? And now look, and I'm just, the sky's the limit.
Yeah.
It's powerful.
It is powerful. It is. I think one of the things in my experience of kind of trying to help people deal with their own shame is that they really need to understand and believe the power of the blood of Jesus. I don't know if that's where we're going to end or where
that's
we're going to get
there. Let's wrap it up there.
But man, oh man, if you don't understand what Jesus did for you, then you're always going to be basing it on, I blew it, I blew it, I blew it, I blew it. How can he love me? How can he forgive me? I've said it, I'm sorry before. Did I really mean it? All that stuff, those the mental gymnastics that we play. But if we really understood the incredible power of the blood of Jesus to cleanse and remove the pain. And the reason I like to say it this way, especially when I'm talking to somebody about shame, is that he took the shame.
Yeah.
He not only took the sin, but he took the shame of that sin into his own body and died and paid the penalty forever. I don't have to carry that shame anymore. I don't have to carry that guilt anymore. Once I own it, I mean, I'm forgiven even before I own it, the truth is, biblically.
Yeah.
But when I own it and I say, Lord, I've blown it. God be merciful to me, a sinner. The Bible says that man is justified, declared right.
Yeah.
And when I really get that, I don't have to waste time like feeling shameful, pulling away from God, lying to myself or lying to people around me or carrying about this, man, I hope they never find out the truth about me kind of a thing.
Yeah.
You know, it's just, you don't have to do it.
Yeah.
I used to do yo-yos a lot, and if you've ever had a yo-yo, you can get it to the point where it'll go down, it'll stay down, it'll just spin down there. And I think that's what happens in Christians' lives sometimes, is they fail, they get down there, and they just continue to spin around. And they're not going anywhere, they're not coming back up in joy, they're just carrying about this weight that they're not even sure what it is. It's shame, and it's a waste, and it's sad. And I've done it myself. I've got a master's degree in it. I know how to do it.
Yeah.
But I've also experienced the fact that I don't have to waste those minutes beating myself up, waiting till I feel truly repentant or proving to God that I'm serious.
Yeah.
I just say, whoa, Lord, that's true. And the light goes on. The blood of Jesus is right there.
Yeah.
And man, oh man, oh man, what incredible joy. And talk about joy and worship.
Yeah.
That's when you can
restoration.
Lord, I can't believe what kind of a God you are.
Yeah. I've experienced moments like that.
Oh, it's just, and that's when the radiance comes back, where
now
all of a sudden, instead of my sin defining me or imprisoning me or limiting me, my sin has actually propelled me into a deeper relationship with God. Martin Luther said once, if it were not for my sin, I would not have known grace. Well, so that, in a way, that's saying, thank God even for this wrong that allowed me to experience how right God is.
The depths allow me to know the heights.
Oh my gosh.
Yes.
You know, it's so powerful, Mark. I'm so glad you brought that up.
That was really good.
The blood of Jesus is enough. We think of the agony of the cross, but we don't think of the shame of the cross. We don't think of, the Bible actually says that Jesus became a curse on our behalf.
Yeah.
That's a ton of shame.
Yeah.
He became a curse, and he bore all that so we could be completely forgiven. And I think this is so powerful. And we spin this whole podcast back around to the beginning, the Garden of Eden, where they ran from God, who is the true source of life and hope and deliverance for their shame. And though they couldn't run to him, he ran to them. And he said, someday the seed will come and crush the head of the serpent.
That.
Isn't that powerful?
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, because he is the source of redemption and freedom from our sin and shame.
Yeah.
Blood of Jesus.
I have a picture that I just love. My mom got it for me for Christmas a few years ago. And it's got Eve, and she has her head down. And it's got Mary, and I think she's got her hand on her belly. And it's the two of them together. And it's just so powerful.
Fulfilling that promise.
Fulfilling the promise.
Wow.
Fulfilling
wow.
the
makes
promise.
You want to cry. Yeah.
And
it's powerful.
Just, oh, I love it.
Yeah.
I love it.
Yeah.
It's such a good reminder.
Well, I think we project upon God what we feel. You know, if you hurt me, you sin against me, I don't like you very much.
Yeah.
I'm mad at you.
Yeah.
And but to see that God pursued them when they weren't pursuing him, they were hiding from him while he's searching for them, even though he knew where they were.
Yeah.
You know, he's running to them while they're running away.
Yeah.
I think if we really understood who God is and how loving he is and the depths and the lengths to which he would go to restore us, we wouldn't waste time pulling away from him.
Spinning
we'd run
on the bottom.
Yeah, we just were spinning at the bottom. It's a waste of energy. And I've had stories of guys who started to get little glimpses of this. I think I've told the church this story about a guy that was really addicted to pornography and felt so shameful about it. He was ensnared, and the more he felt shameful, the more he would be driven to his addiction. And one time while he's actually literally watching pornography, he had this thought, God loves me in this moment as I am right now, not when I'm better. He loves me and accepts me as I am. And it was it was for him this life-giving moment where he goes, wait a minute, I don't have to do this. I have a relationship with God. And he was able to shut it off, turn away, and carried no guilt, no shame. It's not that he said it was okay. He's just saying, I don't need that. And that's where I think this whole conversation could really be explored by people. If you're struggling with an addiction, you're struggling with a bad relationship, you need to look a little bit on, you know, how much shame are you carrying?
Yeah.
Well, and I think we need to do a whole nother podcast on identity sometime. Because
who you believe you are
oftentimes affects the way you behave. Like that man, when he all of a sudden realized that he was loved by God, as Paul would say, a hagios, a saint, a most holy thing, he said, I don't need this.
Yeah.
And I've had moments like that in my life too, where God's met me in my brokenness and I remember who I am, and you go,
you're set free.
I don't need this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, and it's powerful when I remember who I am.
And I have a guy I'm working with right now, and he knows who I am. I hope you're watching, because every time I text him or I send him an email, I call him, oh, mighty man of God.
Yeah.
Because I want him to begin to understand if he sees himself that way, instead of this loser, this failure, this inconsistent individual that he just keeps wanting to talk about. Every time we get together, he wants to talk about how he's failed again. And I go, well, yeah, I'm willing to do that, but you need to understand that's not how God sees you.
Yeah.
And I think that changes everything. So you could even call it, who do you think you are?
Yeah.
That'd be good.
I like it. This is a good podcast. Yeah. Who do you think you are? People think it's like a little 2020 dig. Heather.
Yeah.
Final thoughts, give them to me.
My final thoughts are, when you talked about the trees growing and coming back and seeing them strong and big, it made me think about people that we know, and maybe we've known them at a low point or we've seen them at a lower point. We should never define people there, right? So whether it's someone in our family or whether it's someone we just haven't seen for a while, it can be really easy to joke and to, do you know what I mean? Have those little inside jokes or to see someone in a certain way. But God is at work in their lives. And we need to project that, God's identity, onto them and not let them have this identity of shame, either through nicknames or through just a perception we have in our heart
good
or how
word.
We treat people.
That's such a good
word. So easy to do it and think it's funny and not realize. I mean, my kids have come to me and had to share. They're like, Mom, when you do this or say this, I don't like it.
Yeah.
And I have to realize, oh, I'm like keeping them stuck somewhere that isn't where God has them.
Right.
And so you have to walk through that process of repentance and, you know, other people that you see that maybe they weren't in a great spot the last time you saw them, but to think, what has God done in them? And to meet people with that anticipation of God's work in their life.
Well, I love what you said, Mark, about you signed the email that way. That's exactly what you were saying, Heather, just calling out what's true in their life.
Because
that's what God's doing.
Yeah.
He's calling out what is true. The final thing for me was that image of the yo-yo. I love it so much. And I've seen people do that trick, and I see the yo just spin and spin at the bottom of that string, and then just the gentle tug of the master's hand, and the yo-yo pops back up.
Oh, there you go.
About.
Yep.
I was thinking that when you did that, like,
I'm going to steal that from my next story.
You steal it from me, because I've tried that trick before, and you know when the yo-yo is not responsive, and you give him the tug, but it's not coming? But when you give it that gentle little tug, and the yo-yo responds, it slides right back up to your hand.
Yep.
And I think if you're there today, I feel like God's trying to give you the gentle tug today, and you just need to respond.
Yeah.
I think that's the way to end the podcast. We just want you to respond and just say, Lord, you know, like, I'm down at the bottom. I've been spinning. I'm not going to isolate. I'm going to own it. I'm going to come to the light. I'm going to let your blood in and just confess and believe you forgive me. Just like God, that's what God wants. God wants to pull you right back up to his hand.
Yeah. Well, my only closing thought is it makes me imagine what it would be like to see an entire church body that learned to identify people not based on their bad behavior, but upon who God declared them to be.
It'd be crazy.
How refreshing that would be to be in relationships with people that you know are not going to criticize, critique, judge you, limit you, isolate from you, but they're going to believe the best for you. I've have it with a few friends, but I got to be honest. In my experience of Christianity as a whole, has not been filled with great memories of that sort of thing.
No.
But I think when we talk about this, it makes me kind of just dream for the days when you can just have a group of people who embrace freedom, who embrace the love of God, who believe in the blood of Jesus sufficient for themselves and for each other.
Yeah.
Man, oh man. Then we could be like those Africans, you know, saying, how am I today, brother?
Yeah.
And no fear. There's no fear, because I can be transparent with somebody who I know loves me, who I know has grace. I can relax and be myself. It's really cool. And I think it's happening to little baby steps.
Yeah.
But if you're watching today, I would just encourage you, find some friends that you can get real with.
Yeah.
You know, get into a relationship. Build those now, because you're going to need, and they need you in those real times in our life. So it's been fun. I hope we can do
this
again.
It has been fun. Guys, thank you so much.
Thank you.
ACF, that's all we got time for. Thank you for joining us. Looking forward to our next podcast.
God bless
you guys.
God bless you.
We hope this topic inspired you in your adventure with the Lord. Stay tuned each week for a new podcast. And if you want to support us, not only can you subscribe to our podcast, but you can also spread the word with other friends or family. Maybe it would also be a blessing to them. Well, until next time, may the Lord bless you.